I'm going to just briefly introduce, sorry this is so yellow, but that's what color it is. I'm going to talk just a little bit of background about the four poets that we're going to look at today, starting with Paul Celan. And each one of them was a witness in a different way to the events of the Holocaust. Celan, perhaps of the ones that we'll look at, maybe most touched by those events, although I guess Sutzkever was as well, because he was born in 1920 and grew up in an area that's now kind of in between present-day Ukraine and Romania. We'll look at where it is on the map. A town by the name of Chernovitsky, it was an area that was at the outskirts of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So it was an area that where German was actually spoken. German was often considered the language of high culture. And he also was fluent in Romanian and Yiddish, as well as had conversational knowledge of many other languages, including French and Russian. Its significance because this area came under Russian control in the early 1940s, and later under Nazi control slightly after that. His parents were rounded up, sent to slave labor camps. His mother died, was shot somewhere, perhaps by an Einsatzkommando. His father died of typhus, a disease. He was in a work camp for almost a year and a half. And so having all of this, you know, this is his personal backdrop for the poems that he wrote. And he began writing poetry in earnest in 1943, 1944. So in that period, just after he was liberated, and we don't know the exact dates in which Death Fugue was composed, but most likely in 44 or 45. Nelly Sachs, she was born in Berlin, a German Jewish, of German Jewish descent, into the 19th century. She, like Celan, was well educated in literature, culture, dance, theater, music. She was a poet during the 1920s. Let's say she wrote poetry before the Holocaust, she wrote poetry after the Holocaust. She managed to leave Nazi Germany really at the moment, the very, very last possible moment, amazingly, in 1940, when most German Jews who were still in Germany could not have left. She had a personal connection to a Swedish author, a woman by the name of Selma Lagerlöf. And that person helped her to emigrate to Sweden and get a necessary visa. She remained there until 1970, and in fact would not have been, you know, a personal eyewitness to the horrors of the Holocaust in quite the same way that Celan or Abraham Sutzkever was. And very significantly, she was also the recipient of the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1966, which recognized the breadth and scope of her literary works. Sutzkever was someone who was born in Vilna, the town of Vilna, now in present-day Lithuania, and someone who was in a ghetto, escaped a ghetto, who witnessed the Einsatzkommandos come through and murder by bullets most of the town where he was, witnessed the evacuation of the ghettos, managed to escape, and was someone who participated in something called the Jewish Partisans, which were resistance groups that operated largely behind Soviet lines and essentially lived in the forests in the 1940s. And we'll talk next week a little bit more about the Partisans. One of the things that people often don't know is that there was active Jewish resistance that was even organized. The number of partisans were somewhere between 20 and 30,000 people, primarily in the Ukraine and areas of present-day Russia. And they were essentially resistance, kind of like militia, blowing up, you know, railway lines or ammunition factories, and essentially working somewhat in concert with the Soviets as they were fighting the Germans. And Sutzkever was part of that group, and so much of what he witnessed was both the atrocities perpetrated by the Germans, but also these questions around resistance that were coming about. And finally, Glotzstein, who I don't think I'll have a chance to talk about today, was a Polish Jew emigrated who came back and forth between Poland and the United States, and spent the majority of his time actually in New York, and so composed poetry more as, I'd say, an act of commemoration and memory with regard to where he grew up in Poland. So at the bottom of this, if you scroll down, I did have some questions that you could ask, and I think they're useful questions for beginning to parse the poetry that I gave you. I'm not going to go into these questions per se, but these are ones that perhaps in discussion you'll have a chance to talk about. Okay, so let me turn this on. So introduction to poetry analysis. So this is, for those of you who have, gosh, poetry is so hard to analyze, and I think it is. It is certainly, for lots of reasons. Some of the questions that you may begin to ask that will help you to parse these poems would be questions such as these, and we'll do something similar to film analysis as well. So one thing we want to do is we want to ask about the historical context. I mean, many of these poems, and particularly Holocaust poems, they're inscribed with a place and a time. And that kind of intersection, right, that kind of intersection of a historical moment and a location is really critical for the way in which they testify, right? This is something you want to think about also in your response paper, that they're testifying to a historical moment and a place. And insofar as that inscription or elements of inscribing time and place exist in the poem, I think that they're bearing witness to something that's seen, experienced, or known. And so we want to think about that context. You know, what do we know about the author? What do we know about what did Vilna in July of 1943 mean, right? What are those geographic references that are in so many of these poems? Because the Holocaust, as you already know, was a very large geographical event. It was pan-European. And so to inscribe a place in a poem is also to testify to an event that took place. The language. I mean, most of these poems are written, by the way, the ones I gave you are written in German or Yiddish. And with regard to Yiddish, it's very interesting because I mentioned, I think, in the past that Yiddish was the language spoken by upwards of 80 or 90% of the victims of the Holocaust. And so Yiddish was a language of the victims. Yiddish culture, Yiddish language, Yiddish institutions were all destroyed. So for Sutzkever to write poetry in Yiddish is already an act of defiance because he's taking up a language of the victims. Now, Ceylan thinks a lot about this too. He wrote poetry in Romanian and he wrote poetry in German. And he reflected on it in his poetry. What does it mean to write poetry in the language of the perpetrators? In some ways, this is a central question for Ceylan. When he writes in German, and even in the first poem I'll talk to you about, he reflects on the painfulness of the German language, which he associates with culture, philosophy, music, all the things that he had studied in school, and yet he also knows that language has been utterly corrupted by the Nazis. Think of the language of the Wannsee Conference, that bureaucratized German, that it's technified, that it's just turned into the language of destruction. Is it possible to reclaim the language? Is it possible to interrogate the language? How do you do so? And so this issue of language, not even obvious. We're reading the poems in English translation, but don't forget, they came from German or Yiddish. Ask yourself about the title. Titles often convey a lot of, meaning. Thinking about the tone, and I think a lot of poets are really struggling with this. What tone would be appropriate for talking about the Holocaust? And especially when the tone seems to be maybe at odds with the solemnity or the soberness or the horror of the event. Why would you use rhyming couplets? A, B, a kind of very basic poetic structure to talk about something as horrific as the Holocaust. Like maybe there's something there, not in terms of mocking, but in terms of thinking about, the relationship between a poetic language that perhaps stands at odds, maybe very fundamentally, with what it's ostensibly talking about. So you have to think about structure, rhythm, cadence, repetition. The poems are often full of references, not just to geography, but history, culture, religion. You know, if you don't know who these people or references are, Google. Look them up, because oftentimes they open up a whole world of intertextual relations. You might ask about who the poet is addressing and why. Well, this is an interesting question. Like, who's the audience? Like, who is this poem, written for? The imagery in the poem, what it signifies, What kind of language? Is it metaphorical? Ceylon would often say that he doesn't write metaphors. And this is really interesting, because many times when we analyze poems, we think about, oh, it's a metaphor, it stands for something else. He'll say that my poems are not metaphorical ever. They stand for historical reality. And that's a really interesting thing, because now you have a poet, you know, coming from the realm of the imagination, perhaps the symbolic, the metaphorical, you know, we think of these things that stand for other things. He says it doesn't stand for anything else. It stands for what it is. So, with regard to Holocaust poetry, you know, I think what's about that. I mean, almost talking about Holocaust poetry seems almost like an oxymoron. Like, could there be poetry about the Holocaust? I thought poetry was about things that, you know, are beautiful, or things that are elevated, things that are about culture. But of course, there is a genre, and you're familiar with it, with regard to talking about war. You probably read poems that, again, you know, use language to look at the most horrific or heinous of human, you know, events. And so I would say Holocaust poetry would fit within that kind of tradition. And finally, I would ask you, you know, to look at the individual words and associations, because oftentimes those words, because we have to look so closely, will again open up a whole range. So let's talk about this one. This is Nearness of Graves. It's dated from 1943. And this is a poem that has those kind of rhyming couplets, one of Ceylon's earliest poems. Still do the southerly bug waters know, mother, the waves whose blows wounded you so. Still does the field with those windmills remember how gently your heart to its angels surrendered. Can none of the aspens and none of the willows allow you their solace, remove all your sorrows? And does not the god with his blossoming wand go up in the hills, climbing hither and yon? Can you bear, mother, as once on a time, this gentle, this German, the pain-laden rhyme? In German, it's Unduldest du Mutter wie einst, ach, daheim, den leisenden Deutschen, den schmerzlichen Reim. So this is, you know, again, I would start with the title, Nearness of Graves. There's a geographical element, closeness to something, but yet closeness is something that doesn't exist, right? We already talked about graves. Most of the victims of the Holocaust had no graves, or if they did have a grave, they had a mass grave. And so what does it mean to be near to mass graves? Or what does it mean to be near to people that were just annihilated and have no graves? So in some ways, there's a kind of oxymoron already connected in the title. And yet it's about, I don't know if you know the geographic reference, the bug is a river. A river on the edge of where Ceylon grew up. So his mother has been taken away. I mentioned that already, right? She had, like his father, taken to a slave labor camp and probably shot somewhere. We don't know where. She has no grave. And so to talk about having a grave is also to talk about not having a grave. Who are the witnesses? Like, who saw these things? Well, the bugwater, the windmills, the aspens, the leaves, right, the wind. There are no witnesses, right? There's no one who is there to even tell them, you know, what happened to your mother, this is where she is. And so he's taking, in some ways, and this is amazing, you know, Renee Firestone talks about this. I don't know if you remember, towards the end of her testimony, she says, what if these poles could talk? Right? What if these columns could talk? What if these structures could say what they saw? In some ways, Ceylon's saying the same thing. Still did these southerly bug waters know. The river knows? The waves know. Still does this field with these windmills remember? The windmills remember? Right? These are the witnesses. Because the human witnesses aren't there. They were all killed, or they're Nazi soldiers and they're not testifying. And so who's left to bear witness? It's just nature. Or those objects, you know, built by human beings. The last line is interesting. And can you bear, mother, as once upon a time? Like, can you bear me to write this in German? The gentle, the German, the pain-laden rhyme? Can you bear the German language? It was his first language. It was a language, again, of culture. It was a language he learned because he wanted to go, to university. It was a language that was kind of a global European language in the early 20th century. But it's a language, again, that had been so corrupted, right? A language that had been taken by the Nazis and turned into the most technified, bureaucratic, horrific, those terms that they invented to talk about what they were doing. Again, think of the language of the Wannsee Conference and think of the language that he's trying to almost rework and reclaim. So this is the region, by the way. This is, so where he grew up is, so what you're looking at is Romania, obviously, just north of Bulgaria. The outskirts of the Hungarian Empire, so Budapest is right here. The Hungarian Empire would have gone as far as around here at the beginning of the 1930s, well, actually, at the end of World War I, rather. And this is where Elie Wiesel grew up, the town of Siegnet, which is in Transylvania. So he came from right here. Paul Celan came from right there, very close by. And this is the Bug River right here that he's referring to. And this was all annexed, including where he was, by the Soviet Union. And then the Germans conquered this entire region shortly after, so in 41, 42. We'll talk about Bulgaria down here on Tuesday. So I'm going to turn to another poem, and this one's called Black Flakes. And already in the title, you get a sense of that kind of almost an oxymoronic title, because he's talking about snow, right? Snow has fallen with no light. Black flakes, the cleansed, the clarity, the purity of snow, the kind of the beauty, and yet it's been turned into something else, right? It's been taken and twisted around. Perhaps those black flakes are no longer snow, but perhaps there's smoke, you know, from a crematoria. Snow has fallen with no light. A month has gone by now, or two, since autumn and its monkish cowl brought tidings my way, a leaf from Ukrainian slopes. So this is a leaf from Ukrainian slopes, meaning he's gotten, it's a note. So a note, and this is a quotation here in a poem, or at least a reworking of a quotation. It's a note ostensibly from his mother about what happened to his father, or the fact that his father had died. She says, remember, it's wintry here too, wherever she is, for the thousandth time now. In the land where the broadest torrent flows, Yakov's heavenly blood, blessed by axes, O ice of unearthly red, their hetman wades with all his troops into darkening suns. Oh, for a cloth, child, to wrap myself when it's flashing with helmets, when the rosy flow bursts, when snowdrift sifts your father's bones. Hooves crush the song of the cedar, a shawl, just a thin little shawl. So I keep by my side. Now you're learning to weep, this anguish, this world that will never turn green. My child for your child. Autumn bled all away. Mother, snow burned me through. I sought out my heart so I might weep. I found, oh, the summer's breath. It was like you. Then came my tears. I wove the shawl. It's a hard poem to begin to parse. It's a poem that maybe you feel some of the pain and anguish in the way in which he's put this together. He talks about, you know, the juxtaposition of imagery here, coldness and warmth. How would you begin to think about this? I mean, if you just had to tell me some of the elements, how would we even start to talk about a poem like this? It's not easy. What do you think? Are there images that stand out to you, or language? Thoughts?
When it says snow burning
the bridge,
Right.
Yeah, so you're talking about the snow burned me through. I mean, this is a really interesting thing. I mean, I guess it could be so cold, you could imagine the coldness burning one through. But you could also imagine it being in kind of oxymoronic, that is, flakes that turn black, snow that burns, comfort that can't happen. All these aspects of, you know, seeking warmth, seeking comfort, seeking a shawl, right? The anguish, the fact that the world will never turn green, my child, for your child, meaning there's no future. the Ukrainian slopes. These are those uncertain landscapes, those landscapes where his parents were taken, where he was taken, those places that, again, they signify in some regard geographically, and yet they're also the unknown, right? So he doesn't know where his parents are taken. He doesn't know where this note comes from. And yet, amazingly, he says, the snowdrift sifts your father's bones. The snowdrift sifts your father's bones. I mean, what a profoundly, you know, disturbing image, that the snow is just sifting through your father's bones, right? No graves, no marking, your father, you know, what's become of him, you know, just nature is sort of running its course. So this is a poem certainly of anguish, certainly of searching, certainly of an attempt, I think, to bear witness to what we called last time an emotional reality, but also a historical reality of what it meant for families to be separated. And to think about how a poem can do this in a way perhaps that's different than a memoir or a video testimony, something that I think, you know, I really want you to try to, you know, answer, try to think about. I'm going to turn to Sutskever briefly and look at a poem that also is given a very precise date, the Vilna Ghetto, July 28, 1943. So this is the sort of height of the evacuation of the Jews in Vilna. Most had actually already been killed by Einsatz commandos. A few were still in the ghetto before it was evacuated. And this is a song, I think, really, or a song as a poem, really marked by a tremendous anger. And so, you know, think about the emotionality here. It's called Burnt Pearls. It's not just because my words quiver, like broken hands grasping for aid, or that they sharpen themselves like teeth on the prowl in darkness, that you, written word, substitute for my world, flare up the coals of my anger. It's because your sounds glint like burnt pearls discovered in an extinguished pyre, and no one, not even I, shredded by time, can recognize the woman drenched in flame, for all that remains of her now are these gray pearls smoldering in the ash. You know, it's outrageous. The words quiver because language can't describe, right? What the eyes see and he tries to put into language, there's a dissonance, right? He's probably looking at what was maybe a mass grave that had been burned by the Nazis in a kind of funeral pyre. Perhaps he saw it, perhaps he heard about it. It's not clear, you know, was he actually there? I mean, it's hard to know. I mean, a poem, of course, has poetic liberties. But maybe it's something that he sees the aftermath of. I cannot recognize the woman drenched in flame because all that remains are these pearls that she ostensibly wore around her neck. The poem cuts off. I mean, this dash at the end here, I think, is so significant. Like, what else can you say? How much more can I say? Smoldering in the ash. And he just leaves us there. And yet, it's given a time and space. It's given the Vilna Ghetto, July 20th, 1943. It's given a title of Burnt Pearls. This person doesn't have a name, but yet it's a person. Person doesn't have that humanity. We don't know who is this person. And how do we talk about it? The words quiver. The written word, he says, substitutes for my world and flares up the coal of anger. Because again, it's language trying to process a reality, a language trying to bear witness to a reality that really is almost incommensurate with any language. Some thoughts about the Vilna Ghetto, just so I get some historical background here, and I'll spend some time about this on next week. But Vilna was a part of sometimes in Poland, sometimes Lithuania, depending on who was ruling. But it was considered, it had a long history of Jewish culture, a kind of spiritual center. Some very famous authors, both Jewish and non-Jewish, came from there, like Leo Tolstoy, Yiddish modernist Shalom Aleichem, the artist Marc Chagall, the poet Chaim Bialik. So it was Vilna was a kind of cultural center, and had about 60,000 Jews in 1939, almost, more than half of them were killed. I mentioned in the forests outside of the Ponary by Einsatzgruppen, And two ghettos were established. One was evacuated shortly after this poem, so this is July 28, 1943. The entire ghetto was evacuated in September of that year, and most of the people that were there were killed. It's also a place where the resistance began, and I mentioned as well that Sutskever was part of this united partisan organization which formed in 42, and mainly of men and women who either escaped the ghetto or who were able to escape Nazi the Nazis and not be taken to a ghetto. And they fought in forests, often behind enemy lines. And one of his, another poem that I gave you called The Lead Plates of Rome's Printers is a poem kind of calling out the forces to rally, essentially, a resistance to the Nazis. I'm going to read you another poem. This one written slightly later. So this is after it looked as it was after Soviet troops had began to turn the Germans back substantially. This is towards the end period of the war. Sutskever himself had made it to Moscow by this time. He actually had survived. And this poem was probably a reflective poem, thinking back about things that he probably had seen. It's a kind of a rhyming couplet, sort of A-B-A-B. And it's really, this is one of those poems that I think, you know, jars us in some ways because of the simplicity of its rhyming structure and yet the horror of what it's talking about. Did you ever see, in fields of snow, frozen Jews in row upon row? Breathless they lie, marbled and blue, of death in their body, no hint and no clue. Somewhere their spirit is frozen and saved, like a golden fish in a frozen wave. Not speaking, not silent, just thinking bright, the sun too lies frozen in snow at night. On a rosy lip and the freeze still glows, a smile will not move, not budge since it froze. Near his mother, a baby, starving, at rest. How strange, she cannot give him her breast. The fist of a naked old man in surprise, he cannot release his force from the ice. So far I have tasted all kinds of death. None will surprise me, will catch my breath. But now, overcome in this mid-July heat by a frost like madness right in the street, they come toward me, blue bones in a row, frozen Jews over plains of snow. My skin is covered with a marble veil. My words slow down, my light that is frail. My motions freeze like the old man's surprise who cannot release his force from the ice. How do we talk about such a poem? I mean, even begin to like think of the imagery that's here. I mean, how would you begin to? I mean, can we see this as testimony? I don't know. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, it's not clear. Is he talking about something that maybe was in winter? But then he says here, but now overcome in this mid-July heat by a frost like madness right in the street. So is it still in July? Is it a frost that struck at that moment? Are these people like bodies that are just laying there? I mean, in many ways, I would say it's a condensation of probably many images. I mean, if you've seen many things horrifically, you know, over months or even years, to put all these images together, right, these horrible images, and think, how do I take these visual images and experience and put them into a language, right? And so I imagine part of it may be that. But it's also, you know, reflecting, I think, more broadly on, I mean, you know, well, think of this first question. I mean, such a, can you imagine? I mean, who would ask, did you ever see, like, hey, did you ever see in fields of snow frozen Jews in row upon row? Like, what kind of question is that? Right? I mean, it's almost a question that you can't even imagine having to ask or having asked at all. And yet, there are probably some people who would say, yes, I saw that. I too saw these fields of dead bodies, right? Frozen. So, you know, again, you know, taking the most, you know, the really these horrible images and horrible experiences and thinking how to translate that into a language. And yet, the language has a kind of, I don't know how you would describe it, but maybe there's a kind of playfulness in the rhyming couplet, and why that playfulness seems at very much at odds with the seriousness and solemnity. How do you?
Yeah, I was thinking it almost sounds a little bit like a, probably the right term, like a nursery rhyme, like a nursery rhyme.
Hmm.
So, tone in which you read it. It's very lighthearted.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very easy to remember, like, the ending, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Almost as if you're going to learn this and then pass it on to someone. So
Mm. Interesting. Yeah, like a nursery rhyme that could be kind of learned and passed on or sung even by, you know, by children.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, and what a, you know, horrible thought that is as well.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, Sarah?
Mm. The last one at the end, the imagery kind of suggests that he is becoming frozen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. Exactly. Yeah, this repetition of my right here, three times in a row, my skin is covered, my words slow down, my emotions freeze. Exactly, the author's affected by this, right? It's almost as if he almost needs to go back to maybe the most kind of childish kind of like language, like the most basic kind of poem, a rhyming couplets, because it's like starting over and realizing that he can't, you know, that he is, you know, profoundly affected by this, right? That there's a veil, there's everything is collapsing. How does one bear witness to these horrors? And again, this is an aspect of testimony. Again, you get this with Renee Firestone, those moments in her speech where she can't put into language what she saw, or that she tries repeatedly to put it into language and yet can't quite approximate it. I feel like this is also something that these poets are struggling with. Good, there's much more to say, but I want to move on because there's a couple other things. Look at one poem in particular by Nellie Sachs that I think is really interesting, especially in light of next week where we talk about, you know, this question of bystanders and resistance and so forth. This is a poem that doesn't come from within the Holocaust in the sense of an experiential thing that she saw, but it more is a question, I think, of putting into poetic language a moral quandary that many people, I imagine, had about what do you do when you know or see things around you and yet you don't act. And so this poem, for her, called You Onlookers, is an amazingly accusatory poem. That is, it's accusing these people who saw things and didn't do anything. So here's how it sounds. You onlookers, whose eyes watch the killing as one feels a stare at one's back, you feel on your bodies the glances of the dead. How many dying eyes will look at you when you pluck a violet from its hiding place? How many hands be raised in supplication in the twisted martyr-like branches of old oaks? How much memory grows in the blood of the evening sun? Oh, the unsung cradle songs in the night cry of the turtle dove. Many a one might have plucked stars from the sky. Now the old well must do it for them. You onlookers, you who raise no hand in murder, but who did not shake the dust from your longing, you who halted there where dust is changed to light. So what's the accusation? Who, these onlookers, what do they do or they not do? Well, they watched. They stood by. Yeah, what else? You raise no hand in murder. Things they didn't do. You watched a killing. Maybe now you feel a stare at your back. You raise no hand in murder. You knew maybe what was going on, didn't do things. Mm. Yeah. Yeah, so it was also accused people, you said, of living on and kind of like without, you know, confronting it, right? So it's not just onlookers at that moment, but also onlookers maybe to history where it's like, yeah, I know this happened over there, it was bad, you know, but let's go on, you know, we need to just move on with our lives. In some ways, we become an onlooker. We become an onlooker to the past where we don't register its meaning in how we behave at this moment. And that's kind of a really, then you onlookers also becomes us. And that to me is a really profound thing. It's almost like safe to say, oh, those onlookers in 1943 in Germany who didn't speak out. But what happens when she's saying you onlookers at UCLA in 2017? Suddenly, Those eyes that watch the killing as one feels a stare at one's back, you feel on the bodies the glance of the dead. What happens if she's talking to us? What if we take this poem, you know, into the present, and then it becomes, you know, deeply unsettling, and it kind of raises an existential question of, you know, what do we know? What do we do? At what point do we, at any point in our lives, intervene in a way when we are ourselves privileged not to be targeted? So again, the position of the bystander is a really interesting moral position. It's like you're not a perpetrator, you're not a victim, but because of the privilege that you happen to have, you can be an onlooker and therefore make a decision either to act or not act. And the safety of not acting also means you have to, in some ways, as she says, live with the glance of the dead staring at your back forever. Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe. Maybe so. I mean, you could see maybe he's not even just humanized. I mean, maybe there's, maybe you could see higher powers there too. Yeah, I think that here she's talking primarily about, you onlookers goes directly to that first line, whose eyes watch the killing, and those onlookers seem to be, you know, human beings. But, also human beings capable of action, you know, who raise no hand in murder, but who do not shake the dust from your longing, who halted, you stopped. At some point you decide, I'm not going to move any further. I'm not going to act. Let me, I want to go to Ceylon, because there's a number of things that, and we'll go to, I have a half hour, so I'll make sure it'd be great if you stayed, because I think that the next part, I really want to focus on Death Fugue and his kind of thinking about poetry. So we looked at a couple poems from Ceylon already, The Nearness of Graves and Black Flakes. I wanted to show you a speech that he gave in 1958, sort of about his poetry and sort of the philosophy behind it. And it really goes back to that issue of language again, and the German language in particular. And he says, you know, in light of all these losses, all these horrors, all these bad things that happen, you know, all this mass, you know, horror, something remained in the midst of all this losses, and that's language. That is to say, language. The German language survived. It went through this. But he says the language remained not lost in spite of everything, but it had to pass through something. It had to pass through what he calls its answerlessness, pass through frightful muting, pass through the thousand darknesses of death-bringing speech. So you have the German language, right? It's being appropriated by the Nazis, being used by the Wannsee Conference to talk about those horrible terms of, you know, evacuation and Vernichtung and all these terms we've been talking about. And yet, that's the death-bringing speech. Those are the darknesses, right? It passed through this, and the question is, can the language be reclaimed? Can it be used in a way that's humane again? For Ceylon, he imagines poems as always dialogical. That is, they reach out to something or reach out to someone. He calls it as even like a message in a bottle, in the sense that you send it out into the world, but it only becomes useful if someone actually takes it in. You actually find the bottle, open it up and see what's there, and read it. And so in that sense, a poem is like a dialogue. It's sent out not always in the greatly hopeful belief that somewhere in some time it can wash up on land. Poems are making towards something. Toward what? Towards something standing open, meaning someone ready to listen. Someone listening, perhaps toward an addressable you, to someone who wants to take in that message. And I'd say more broadly, testimony functions in exactly the same way. You can't testify if there isn't a listener. Right? I mean, if you're testifying in the darkness, it's not testimony. Testimony requires an audience. It requires someone who's open, listening, and addressable you. And this is also goes back to Primo Levi's nightmare of testimony in the camp when he was worried that his sister didn't want to hear about his experiences. The nightmare of the unlistened to story is the very basis of testimony. That's the nightmare, that no one will want to hear it. And so in the same way, he's thinking about poetry. It requires that you. It requires that listener. It requires that person being testified to. And therefore, it's a kind of dialogical or ethical relationship. I'm gonna skip over that. I'm just gonna go to Death Fugue because I'm just in interest of time. So this is perhaps one of the most famous poem that Ceylon wrote, and maybe one of the most famous in all of Holocaust poetry, called Death Fugue. It was originally published in Romanian, as you can see over here, as kind of Death Tango. My Romanian is non-existent, but Tango Morti, it looks like, Mortu. And it was prefaced in 1947, when it was first published, by a little introductory note, which said, "The poem, whose translation we are publishing, is built upon real facts. In Lublin, as in many other Nazi death camps, one group of the condemned was forced to sing while others dug graves." And here I gave you a picture of another kind of death tango, and this is in a labor camp outside of Lvov from 1942. And what you have are the Jewish prisoners forced to play violins and sing songs as Nazi officers look in, and the condemned man is in the middle there, probably shortly before he's shot. So there's a kind of structural kind of absurdity, right, to this. I mean, in some ways, you remember this in Elie Wiesel's Night with Juliet playing Beethoven in a death march. In that case, I think, you know, a moment of kind of life-giving. Here, you have a moment of almost absurdity, you know, taking, you know, things that we associate with beauty and culture and values and humanity, music, and making people prisoners play as, you know, as prisoners are being killed or shot. So this death tango is, or this death fugue, essentially is taking, again, you know, a musical tradition, fugue, Bach, taking a musical tradition and again inverting it to make it a death fugue. So we'll look at the poem, and I'm going to kind of also listen how you let you listen to Ceylon read it, and I'll also play you a fugue, and so you can kind of see how it has a musical structure. So the poem I'll read, and it's divided into four sections. Black milk of daybreak, we drink it at evening, we drink it at midday and morning, we drink it at night. We drink and we drink. We shovel a grave in the air where there you won't lie too cramped. A man lives in his house, he plays with his vipers, he writes. He writes when it grows dark to Deutschland. Your hair, your golden hair, Margareta. He writes it and steps out of doors and the stars are all sparkling. He whistles his hounds to come close. He whistles his Jews into rows, has them shovel a grave in the ground. He commands us to play up for the dance. Black milk of daybreak, we drink you at night, we drink you at morning and midday, we drink you at evening, we drink and we drink. A man lives in this house, he plays with his vipers, he writes when it grows dark to Deutschland, your golden hair, Margareta, your ashen hair, Sulamit. We shovel a grave in the air where you won't lie too cramped. He shouts, jab the earth deeper, you lot there, you others sing up and play. He grabs for his rod and his belt, he swings it, his eyes are so blue. Jab your spades deeper, you lot there, you others play on for the dancing. Black milk of daybreak, we drink you at night, we drink you at midday and morning, we drink you at evening, we drink and we drink. A man lives in his house, your golden hair, Margareta, your ashenous hair, Sulamit. He plays with his vipers, he shouts, play death more sweetly, this death is a master from Deutschland. He shouts, scrape your strings darker, you'll rise then as smoke to the sky. You'll have a grave, then in the clouds, there you won't lie too cramped. Black milk of daybreak, we drink you at night, we drink you at midday. Death is a master aus Deutschland, we drink you at evening and morning, we drink and we drink. This death is ein Meister aus Deutschland, his eye is so blue. He shoots with you with shot made of lead, shoots you level and true. A man lives in his house, your goldenest hair, Margareta. He loses his hounds on us, grants us a grave in the air. He plays with his vipers and daydreams, der Tod ist ein Meister aus Deutschland, dein goldenes Haar, Margareta, dein aschenes Haar, Sulamit. So this is an extraordinary poem in many ways. This translation, I should say, was made by a professor at Stanford named John Felstiner, and he made a deliberate, he deliberately didn't translate all of the German into English. And so this decision to actually leave parts of the poem in German was not Ceylon's decision. It was actually the translator's decision. And it has an effect that I think is really quite magical and also disturbing in that it kind of takes us into the language that Ceylon is writing. I mean, in some ways, it takes us into the German language and experience. So to talk about, you know, we talked about black flakes earlier. Now we're talking about black milk. We're talking about the repetition. Black milk of daybreak, as we drink it in morning and midday and morning and night. We drink and we shovel. In some ways, this poem is obviously marked by repetition, right? You have one, two, three, four times. But each time it's slightly different. So it's a slightly different variation. One has a sense probably of like slave laborers, you know, there digging in the ground, making graves, making quarrying, doing whatever. And you have this other figure in the poem, this Nazi man who lives in a house, right? So the poem is about, you know, people, slave laborers, digging, surviving perhaps on black milk, this repetition of day in and day out as a slave laborer, and the Nazis saying, hey, you dogs, you hounds. In German, it's Ruden. It rhymes with Juden. These two words rhyme. It's amazing. He whistles to his Ruden, come close. He whistles to his Juden and to Rose. The linkage between those two terms, the dogs attack the Jews. Get in the row, shovel in the ground. He commands us, dance. How do we begin? Again, you know, I've given you some insight already how to parse it. How do you think about the repetition here? I mean, it's a fugue, after all. Does anyone know what a fugue is, musically? Yeah? Right. So the fugue has repetition. That's one aspect to it. Yeah, Bach is perhaps best known for his fugues. Sarah?
Doesn't it have like two themes that are kind of like each other?
Right. So it has more than one theme. So it introduces a theme, and then there's kind of like a counter theme, and then that's another counter theme, and it kind of like, it's a motif that changes. Almost like Black Milk of Daybreak, Black Milk of Daybreak, Black Milk of Daybreak. But yet each time it's slightly different as it goes. And so it might be of use for us to actually listen to what a fugue sounds like. And so I'm going to play it and really, you know, attune yourself to the sounds, because you'll appreciate not only the repetition, but the way in which you introduce one motif, a counter motif, then a counter, another counter, and at the end it all kind of comes together. And in this case, it comes together as a kind of polysymphonic, you know, kind of culmination. In Ceylon's poem, it comes together in the death of the two women. So listen to the fugue, it's like 2.5 minutes.
Thank you.
So how would you talk about the musical fugue? I mean, I gave you some pointers. This is what I said before. It's obviously a polyphonic composition, so many pieces enter in. A motif is introduced. Bum, 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 bum. And it comes again as a dominant, then as a less dominant piece. They play off against one another, and it kind of builds. Is there anything else that we can say about its structure in terms of its musical? Like as you listen to Bach's fugue, I mean, what would you, can we find a language to talk about it? Intermingling in the middle, yeah. Right. So it starts, you know, one piece, another piece, they begin to kind of mix in different ways, almost like a dance of sorts. And by the end, they start to separate, they come back together, and they culminate in this final piece. And then there's a kind of cathartic sense, like it gets to a high point, and then it's almost like a release, da-da-da-da, at the end, it kind of quiets back down and it kind of fades out. Anything else that you want to say about the structure, musical structure of the fugue that you noticed in listening to that? I mean, obviously, it's also beautiful, right? I mean, it sounds, I mean, amazing. I mean, there's a sort of beauty about hearing this. I mean, a kind of almost a gentleness. And really, you know, it's obviously, it's a beautiful musical composition. So let's go back to Ceylon. And I'm actually going to let you listen in German to him doing this. And I'm going to point out a couple things as we do so. Because I think that listening to him read his composition in German, you also get a sense about what he privileges in the composition. So like the words, and I'll follow along in English, and then we'll talk a little bit about the significance of those words. So that's the poetry of Paul Celan read by the author.
Todeskugel. Schwarze Milch der Frühe, wir trinken sie abends, wir trinken sie mittags und morgens, wir trinken sie nachts, wir trinken und trinken. Wir schaufeln ein Grab in die Lüfte, da liegt man nicht eng. Ein Mann wohnt im Haus, der spielt mit den Schlangen, der schreit, wenn es dunkelt nach Deutschland. Dein goldenes Haar, Margarete. Er streift es und tritt vor das Haus und es blitzen die Sterne. Er pfeift seine Rüden herbei, er pfeift seine Juden hervor, lässt schaufeln ein Grab in der Erde. Er befiehlt uns, steht auf nun zum Tanz. Schwarze Milch der Frühe, wir trinken dich nachts, wir trinken dich morgens und mittags, wir trinken dich abends, wir trinken und trinken. Ein Mann wohnt im Haus, der spielt mit den Schlangen, der schreit, wenn es dunkelt nach Deutschland, dein goldenes Haar, Margarete, dein aschendes Haar, Sulamit. Er schaut in ein Grab in den Lüften, da liegt man nicht eng. Er ruft, stecht tiefer ins Erdreich, ihr einen, ihr anderen spielt weiter zum Tanz auf. Er greift nach dem Eisen in Luft, er schwingt, seine Augen sind blau. Stecht tiefer die Spannung hier ein, die anderen spielen weiter zum Tanz auf. Schwarze Milch der Frühe, wir trinken nicht nachts, wir trinken nicht mittags und morgens, wir trinken nicht abends, wir trinken und trinken. Ein Mann wohnt im Haus, dein goldenes Haar, Margarete, dein aschendes Haar, Sulamit, der spielt mit den Schlangen. Er ruft, spielt süßer den Tod, der Tod ist ein Meister aus Deutschland. Er ruft, streicht dunkler die Geigen, dann steigt ihr euch drauf in die Luft. Dann habt ihr einen Grab in den Wolken, dann liegt man nicht eng. Schwarze Milch der Frühe, wir trinken nicht nachts, wir trinken nicht mittags. Der Tod ist ein Meister aus Deutschland. Wir trinken nicht abends und morgens, wir trinken und trinken. Der Tod ist ein Meister aus Deutschland, sein Auge ist blau. Er trifft dich mit bleierner Kugel, er trifft dich genau. Ein Mann wohnt im Haus, dein goldenes Haar, Margarete. Er hisst seine Rüden auf uns, er schenkt uns ein Grab in der Luft. Er spielt mit den Schlangen und träumet. Der Tod ist ein Meister aus Deutschland.
Okay. So thinking about the fugue and thinking about Ceylon read it, what and hearing him read this, what do we learn about the poem? How do we interpret it in maybe another way or a different way? I don't know.
Except in the very last two lines, which kind of ends on something that, like, it's like the juxtaposition of the Nazi ideology of, like, the blonde blue eyes versus the quote-unquote ashness of the Jewish.
Right, so the Nazi here with his rod, with his vipers, with his house, with his blue eyes, with his commands, right? This figure is in the poem as a kind of a figure of commanding. And there's a kind of, in his tone, he reads those lines with intensity. And at the end, you're right to say that there's a kind of, an aspect of someone dying. We'll have to talk about who Margareta and Sulamit are. But someone seems that they're not alive anymore. If you have ashen hair, perhaps you've been killed. You know, the grave and an air. Grave and an air. Graves are obviously not in the air, but one thinks about the crematoria. These connotations become clear. They're victims as well. So there's a kind of play of being a witness, talking about victims, talking about kind of a Nazi idea. What else? You had something?
I was going to say his cadence also, like, emulated a lot of
his cadence, yeah. What is his cadence? How does it change?
Well, it seems like within each stanza, there's some parts where he almost paused within the sentence itself, where he wouldn't see time
pause, and then he'd keep going. Right. So the cadence is, you know, the kind of the almost like the rhythm of the voice as he's reading it. Der Tod ist ein Meister aus Deutschland. I mean, to know that this part at the very end here had to be read so quietly and solemnly, we'd only know that when we heard Ceylon, you know, reading it.
Yeah. Well, I think in that way it, like, really directly matters. Like, hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And that way, like, the way he reads it, he stops after each line, and, like, it seems like they understand more alone. But yeah. Then in the end, like, he never pauses by saying, like, now you drink, you have a day. And, like, he says it all the same.
All the same, exactly. Yeah, right. The parts where he doesn't pause, this black milk of day, but he even accelerates his voice at that last stanza. You have a sense of its inevitability, right? That the fugue is kind of moving towards its end, but also the people's lives are moving towards their end, right? Black milk of daybreak, we drink you at night, we drink you at midday. Death is a master aus Deutschland, we drink you at evening and morning, we drink and we drink. All of this is said almost in one breath. And the kind of the exhaustion, right, of having gone day and day and day and day as a laborer until death, right, which in some ways is the end of the journey from the death fugue. It's not the end of Bach's fugue, of course, but it's the end of the death fugue. Other observations? So if you permit me one last time, I want to play them together. And they're really extraordinary, actually, to hear, not side by side, but instead in their oneness. So I'm going to pause that real quick. And I'm going to let this get to where it needs to be. So what I want you to listen to, if you can, if you're able to do this, listen to the fugue, listen to Ceylon. I'm going to put the poem on and see if you go back and forth, like thinking both linguistically, poetic, structurally, and auditorily, where they come together. So here we go.
Wir schaufeln Grab in den Lüften ein tolles Eck. Ein Mann wohnt im Haus, der schießt mit den Schlangen, der schreit.
Er schreibt es und spricht vor das Haus und es blitzen die Sterne. Er treibt seine Rüden herbei, er treibt seine Juden hervor, lässt schaufeln ein Graf in der Erde. Er befiehlt uns, steht auf nun zum Tanz. Wachse mich, der Frühe, wir trinken dich nachts, wir trinken dich morgens und mittags, wir trinken dich abends, wir trinken und trinken. Ein Mann wohnt im Haus, der spielt mit den Sternen, der schreibt. Er schreibt, wenn es dunkelt nach Deutschland, dein goldenes Haar, Margarete, dein aschendes Haar, Sulamit. Ihr schaut in ein Grab, in den Lüften, da liegt man nicht eng. Er ruft, stecht tiefer ins Erdreich hinein. Die andere stehen weiter zum Tanz auf. Er greift nach der leisen Luft, er schimpft, seine Augen sind blau. Stecht tiefer die Spannung hinein, die andere stehen weiter zum Tanz auf. Schwarze Milch, der Frühe, wir trinken nicht nachts, wir trinken nicht mittags und morgens, wir trinken nicht abends, wir trinken und trinken. Ein Mann wohnt im Haus, dein goldenes Haar, Margarete, dein aschendes Haar, Slavik, der spielt mit den Schlangen. Der Ruf spielt süßer den Tod, der Tod ist ein Meister aus Deutschland. Der Ruf spricht gut, der Kleid, da steigt er als Frau und Ruf.
Does it change? It seems like they need each other. They need each other. The music, the whole cultural tradition, right? All the possibilities of human creation, the beauty, right? Expressivity, and also the most horrific things, right? They and I didn't say need each other in the sense that they need to have one another, but to understand this poem, one has to understand the pinnacle of human expressivity and its absolute nadir. And both are there in this poem, right? Okay, so we'll end. Thanks.